First of all, I am very, very glad to have you on my show, and really, really amazing. I can say, you are from Canada and I am from India. So it is possible only by Zoom that we are connecting each other and we can share some thought regarding the something. And I found that you are doing a great job. Parenting program is a tremendous job, I can say, because nowadays, especially students, or I can say, children are being diverted from their career, from their life, from their studies also. So you are doing a superb job for that. I can say, congratulations. I can give you, clap for that. All right.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate those kind words.
Hey, absolutely. All right. So, myself, Sanjay Agarwal, and I am from India. And nowadays, I'm a soft skill trainer. Okay. And apart from that, I'm also pursuing my master degree, master in business administration from Pune University. And apart from that, I do conversation online, offline, and different things are there. And I love interacting with different people across the globe. So, and I have been interacting so many people, from US, from UK, and from other countries also. And I'm very glad that we are here. And all right, can you tell me something about yourself?
Personally and professionally, I'm aligned. What I mean by that, everything I talk about professionally and what I teach parents and what I talk to teens about and families is what we do in our own family. So I'm not someone who doesn't practice what he preaches. I'm someone who believes in a set of values, a set of what a foundation to parenting is, a foundation to how we interact with one another. So I'm a person who believes in, if we want to have an opportunity at happiness, that we must put action into that. We must create that. It doesn't just happen randomly. We must take control of our life. So I'm a big believer in that, is how do we, let's look at what we want and let's figure out how we get there. And let's design that and take action.
Absolutely. All right. So just so guys, we are having today's our special guest, Michael Larson from Canada, and he's parent educator and speaker, coach, counselor, and peace builder. So we are very glad to have on our show, which is Yes Sanjay show. And the session behind doing this, we want to know something about the parenting program and how can we develop our children, how, what is the requirement, and might be the culture, might be the situation, might be the environment different from India and Canada, but the mind thought process human being is same with everyone. So starting with one question, how did you come to this program? Why did you choose this program?
Yeah, so my program that I've designed, which is a 12-week program, the Empowered Parenting Program, it is basically a culmination of 15 years of my work. It is, I've been working since 2016 with children in many settings. I worked with children in a jail as a counselor. I fostered for 6 years at a specialized treatment home where kids who were coming out of jail on probation, they lived with me, and my goal was to help keep them out of jail. I've also worked in a school for a couple years. So I've been a foster parent, I've been a single parent, I've been a co-parent, I've been a step parent. So when it comes to parenting, I've covered every aspect that you can be as a parent. And I have two daughters right now, a stepdaughter and a bio daughter. And I've just been talking and working with kids for so long. And the common theme that kept coming up when I met with these teens, and yes, people have struggles and stuff, but the biggest thing on their mind was the parent-child relationship. And what does my mom think of me? What does my dad think of me? And I think as parents, we almost, without knowing it, don't realize the damage that our words can do. And we have to be aware of how we talk to our children and how we treat them and how we discipline them. So my program essentially is, letting parents know, this is what works. This is what will effectively help you to raise your children with less fighting. But also, with helping them to achieve the skills they need to be successful or to follow their own path.
Very nice, very nice. Because very rare people do this, and we see also like a parenting program also run by in our India. Very few, I can say very few, like 2-3 people are running this program, and they're not up to their mark, and whatever they promise, promising something and delivering something is, I don't think so. So I think that those people who are watching the videos or podcast on Spotify or any other platform. So if you want your parenting program to be to take in, then you can get all the details from the Michael Larson from the description. That would be very helpful for you. And moreover, we'll talk about more this about this program, and so that we can get more clarification. And one thing I saw that in your bio you have written effective parents rather than emotional parents. All right. So do you think that somehow we have emotions for our children that trigger us in such a way that we try to give all the things whatever they ask for, and without considering that whether it is going to be helpful or not?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that?
Yeah. So when I talk about emotionally parenting, that's where we run into trouble as parents, if we're making our decisions out of emotion. So it can go two ways. Like you said, it can go, well, I'm giving them all this stuff because I want, giving, and, almost raising them to think that things are handed to you, or you're overcompensating because you feel guilty that maybe you and the other parent aren't together anymore, or maybe you made a mistake and you're, buying them things to overcompensate, or you could be stressed out and angry and be yelling at them and punishing them. So emotional parenting can go either way. But to me, where we want to be is we want to enter every conversation and every plan with our children without being emotional, so we can make effective choices. Because we can't listen to somebody if we're in our amygdala and our stress response and our activated emotional part of our brain. Our children won't be able to tell us what they want if they're activated in their emotional brain. So as a parent, we must always be aware of our own emotions. And when our children trigger us, we have to remind ourselves that's a mirror. The triggers are because there's something that they're reminding us of ourselves, that maybe it's something from our childhood or something from our early adulthood that makes us feel
it's cold
or bad.
So much cold here. All right. All right. Okay. Can you tell me what is the degree there, temperature in Canada right now?
Right now, I think it is minus 15.
Minus 15 degrees Celsius right now.
Yeah. Which is actually warm. Which is warm for this time of year.
Oh, no. So, how low does it go?
Well, most winters, we get down to minus 50, minus 40, where you're freezing. Unless you have to cover up every inch of your skin.
All right, you are having right now heater air, in your room. That's why you can sit comfortably.
Yeah, I'm sitting comfortably because I'm in a heated house right now. I'm in my t-shirt. And I'm usually hot. But yeah, it's cold out here outside right now.
All right. What time is there, I think, in the in the evening? Or?
Yeah, it's just about 6 p.m. here in the evening.
Evening. Okay, we are having early morning.
You're in the morning right now?
Early in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, morning. Really? So really early. You're just waking up.
Yes, yes. Actually, when I saw your time, scheduled time and my time, it was absolutely opposite. Okay. But I thought that, if I need to contact or if I need to have conversation, definitely I need to sacrifice something. So today I woke up at 3:30 and I prepared that, definitely I need to get anything. So...
that's impressive. Definitely. Waking up in the middle of the night.
Absolutely. I used to sleep at 10 o'clock at night, and I wake up every day at 4 o'clock or 4:30, because that I am very inspired from the 5 p.m. clock from Robin Sharma.
Okay.
Very inspired. All right. So, okay. Apart from that, I want to ask you one thing, what I found, whenever I also teach, nowadays I don't teach, but I teach or I train online. Okay. But when I was in graduation, that time I used to go to a school and I was teaching my students, school students, I can say. Okay. But that was 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 standard, you can say. Okay. So what I found that the distraction, students having distraction from their different things, from the gadgets, from negative friends, and negative things, that entertainment, which is totally damaging the youth. All right. So these are the things parents sometimes have no control over that. So how can a student avoid distraction in their life? Is there any solution for that?
So the question is, how does a student avoid distractions and stay kind of focused in life?
All right. Yes. How can they concentrate without being disturbed from this kind of thing?
Yeah, well, it's a complex question, but I think someone has to, even at a young age, they got to figure out what is their why. Why are they doing this in school and where are they going? And at a young age, you don't have to exactly know what you're going to do, but you got to ask yourself some questions and have a direction of where you want to head. Because without a direction, without a big enough why to motivate yourself, you can become distracted by so many things, especially in this world now with phones and everything else and peers. So you have to really be living your own life, not just living a life that somebody's telling you to live. So I always tell young people you want to be internally motivated, not externally motivated. You don't want to be motivated to get an item or this or that. You want to be motivated from in yourself that I deserve this. And it starts with self-esteem, with confidence. And then when distractions come, you can block them out and realize that these distractions aren't helping you get where you want to go. And that's a very small way to say it. It's more detailed than that, but that's what I always tell people.
Absolutely. All right. Parents sometimes lose control over their kids and they say that whatever they do, I don't care, or whatever they do. This happens. Yes. Sometimes we see that some parents are very careless for their kids. Yeah. All right. So whatever they do, whatever the children are doing, they don't have any information about it. So don't you think that our youth is going to be the future of our country and they are at wrong place? Don't you think so?
Yeah, I'm a big believer that the youth, and you hear the expression, the youth is the future, the children are the future. And it's true. They're the one, the young people are the ones who are going to the next generation. As they get older, they're the ones that are going to be impacting the world. So as parents, we can't just get to a point where we get upset and just give up and just let them do whatever. We have to stay involved. We have to create, we have to do everything we can to keep this relationship healthy, to support them. And as a parent, we have to, if things aren't going well, we have to go out and learn some new skills. We have to work on ourselves to be able to keep that relationship with the kid. It's not up to the kid to keep the relationship with the parent. It's up to the parent to keep the relationship with the kid. And that's where I think people get into trouble.
Right. Absolutely. Because sometimes we see that the children are doing their duty, but sometimes immaturity, because they don't know whether we should do or not. They do not have any idea. All right. So that it is the responsibility of their parents to make them aware of something, that it should be done or not. Absolutely. But how a parent can be a good parent? Like a good parent means we give the life for suppose I'm a parent of my children. Okay. So what is the precautions or what is the step should I follow so that my children will be better in their future? Is there any process or any steps so that I can follow?
Yeah, there's a foundation to parenting, what I call it. And once you equip yourself with this foundation, then you're going to be better off for any challenges that come. It takes a long time, and that's why I do my program, because it took me 15 years to learn this, and this is what I teach people. So you want to focus on what is your parenting style, and why do you parent this well? Parent, so I, you know, and look at your style. Then you want to focus on communication. How do you effectively communicate with your kids? Listen as much as you talk, and then you also want to focus on not being critical. You want to be curious, and then you want to focus on connecting, spending time, bonding. And you want to focus on how does the brain work? and how do emotions work, and teaching your children from a young age what happens with their body, with their emotions. You want to look at discipline, and this is a big one for parents. Discipline is not to punish. It's not to ground, to take things away. Discipline is actually teaching. That's the definition of discipline, a disciple. So we want to teach our children skills to develop self-discipline. So anytime our child is having a problem, we must look at what skills are they lacking, because their brain is still developing. The brain isn't fully developed until 25 years old. So we have to remind ourselves that to be patient. And if these mistakes aren't on purpose, they're trying their best. So we just have to always teach and show them and help them and support them.
Absolutely. Like the point you said, like punishment, if we talk about India, all right. So we are having a very struggling childhood, we can say, because you know that in India, from our childhood, if we commit any mistake, so our mother, I don't know about Canadian culture, but in India, what happens if you commit any mistake, if you do any mistake, then whatever the Indian mother found that time, they try to beat on that. Whether it is groom, I can say, all right. And any type of stick or anything comes from in front of that Indian mother. Okay. They try to beat that person without worrying about that. So what's your message for them? Do you think they should do or continue with this, or they should stop doing, and they should teach their children how to be disciplined?
Yeah. And that's a big question. And it happens in Canada. It happens in the United States. It happens around the world. This idea of punishment. And to me, that's how a lot of parents used to do it. But now we know better. Research has been done for years and years and years on children and how they develop. And it's been discovered time and time again. Someone who is hit or spanked and taught that way, they grow up with trauma, with issues around that. Because all you're teaching that child is whoever's bigger and stronger gets to tell you what to do, because they can hit you and they can hurt you. So you're controlling them through fear. So when that child grows up, if they're in a relationship with somebody and that person's not doing what they want to do, are they supposed to hit them? Are they supposed to hit their wife, their husband? Are they supposed to hit their friends? So what you're essentially teaching your children is hitting is how we stop people from doing things, which doesn't work. Because when the kids go to school and they get in a fight, how can we as a parent be upset that they're fighting when we are teaching them that that's the answer to problems? We must teach them that violence and hitting is not the answer. It's through teaching and communication where we can repair stuff and learn. So yes, my message is, please do not hit your children. It is not healthy. It does not help them. It hurts them.
Absolutely. Because sometimes they think that, yeah, if we do anything, we'll be beaten. So we stop doing. So their creativity and their thought process also stops there.
Yes.
I think so.
All right. Yes.
And you have been doing this program since long time, I can say like that. All right. So what is the biggest challenges did you find in doing so?
With my program?
Yes. When you interact with a teenager or any type of kid, what is the biggest challenges do you find in kids?
In kids, the biggest challenge I find with parents, if they're changing their approach, is I always remind parents it's going to be hard because the child isn't, it's going to take the child a while to realize you're doing something different. So the biggest challenge as a parent is to stick with it long enough so then your brain gets used to it to create a habit. It takes quite a while to change our own behavior. And then we need to give our child time to respond to our change and change their behavior. So often as parents, the challenge is, well, we try something for a couple of days, it doesn't work. So then we try something else. We must be consistent. We must stick to something and do it long enough to see the results of the work, of the action plan.
Yes. One more question coming in mind that do you think that somehow the habits of a parents drinking, I can say, smoking, I can say, any type of wrong habits, I can say, that is inheriting the child?
Yes, I believe the one of the best and most effective ways to parent is through role modeling as well. Is so not just your words, but your own behavior. So when we, I tell people all the time, focus on parenting yourself. And by default, if you parent yourself, you're parenting your children. So if you make healthy choices and you give up your health, unhealthy habits, and you do this and that, your parents will, your kids will follow your lead. So the same as you just said, if you're doing, if you're making unhealthy choices, your children will be more prone to make unhealthy choices as well, because it's normalized. And they say, well, if you can do it, I can do it as well.
Absolutely. All right. Like one thing, like also there, like sometimes the living is okay, doing is okay, but sometimes food, you know, the food selection is also important for every kid. Like when they are at their growing level, or I can say like a growing stage, that time, do you think also like a food system, or like giving food to a like a kid or teenager is also important for their mind development, brain development, or like body development also, or whatever they should eat?
Yeah, for sure. And depends where we are. And sometimes finances and financial things are an obstacle in terms of buying healthy food. But yeah, I'm a big believer. If we want our brain and we want to be able to make good decisions and not become overwhelmed by emotions, we got to fuel our body in the right way. We got to put the right kind of gas, like a car. You want to put the right kind of fuel in your body and teach your children that, you know, you want to have a healthy diet. You want to avoid sugars. You want to avoid this. Because if that's going on, when we put unhealthy stuff in our body, it makes us feel cranky. It makes us feel irritable. We don't sleep as well. And when we're not functioning well, how can we interact well with our parents or go to school? It's very tied together. We gotta take care of ourselves physically, because it's tied to emotional and mental health as well.
So definitely, that's a great thing I can say. Like one thing, like we find one thing very much in child cases. That anger, the children are getting angry without if they want to get something, or if you want to, they want to have something, they try to become angry. And in that case, the parents become motivated and they try to provide whatever the children ask for. Mm-hmm. So what do you say about that?
So the question is, if a kid gets angry and gets upset, then the parent gives them what they want because they're angry?
Yes, yes. So how can that be solve that problem? Like angry, and that parents is giving the chances for the students and children, and they are just doing all the things. So it is giving a one type of license for the children to do ask for more and more, I can say.
Yeah.
So how can a parent be stop these type of things?
So you, as a parent, you don't want to give in or give things to a child when they're, because they're angry and they're demanding it, or they're threatening or punching something or throwing a tantrum, because you're teaching them that will get them what they want. So I have many, many times sat with an angry kid for hours, and I sit there and I just tell them, I can see you're angry. I'm sorry that you're angry. How can I help you? Is there something I can do? You focus on the anger, and whatever they want, you don't even talk about what they want until the anger has passed. And then once the anger passes, then you can explain to them why it was a no. But nobody wants to hear no when they're upset. So as a parent, we just got to remind ourselves that anger won't last forever. And as our child is doing all this stuff, we just calmly say, this is not okay. Please stop. How can I help you? And you just focus on the anger, not even what they want. And then you just talk about it later. And because that's what a child needs to learn, that you can't always get what you want. That's part of life. We got to handle disappointment. And anger is healthy when we do something healthy with anger. There's healthy ways to release anger.
Very good question. Like anger, apart from that, like, you know, that school going or college going students like fall in love. I hope that that is also applicable in Canada. Also, it is universally like acceptable, I can say. So what is the right age for any teenager to fall in love? Is there any right age, or it is all about maturity, I can say?
Yeah, I don't think there's an age. I think too often we look at numbers as a guideline, but I think the number means nothing. It depends on, like you said, maturity. Like it depends on how that individual presents himself. How are they making these choices? If they meet somebody and 5 minutes later they're saying they're in love with them, well, then obviously they don't understand what love means. And you know, you would, as a parent, you would have conversations with your child. What is love? What is passion? What is like? And there's differences. So I think it's just a matter of your child is ready to be in love when they're ready, if they understand what that means. And as a parents, we don't want to tell our children they can't be in a relationship. We don't want to, we just want to be there to guide them and help them make decisions and let them know relationships are hard work. They're not easy. Like on the TV, in the movies, people fall in love, they go through a challenge, everything's happy. That's not how it works in real life. Relationships are hard work. So it's not as easy as just being in love.
All right. Okay, if I have two things at a time, if I have two things, one is love and is career. So what should we choose as a kid? Career building, like a future building, like they should study and they should look for like what they should do in their future, like getting a job or starting a business.
This is my take on love. And I tell young people this all the time. If you focus on loving yourself and developing a loving relationship with yourself, building character, values, morals, you will find somebody. Love will come to you. But if your sole focus is finding love, and that's all you're looking for, you're going to look for love in the wrong places. So to me, the most important love relationship is with ourselves. So yes, we focus on building ourselves in that. And then a love with somebody else will follow that.
And one thing, like because of love and because of career, we see that most children are in depression and they are full of depression. And they try to adopt some kind of activity like drinking, smoking because of depression. And sometimes they take drugs also. So do you think that how they can handle this situation? Like going into depression and sometimes suicidal cases also happens. All right. So because of career, because of love also. So how can a student handle this type of situation when they are in depression?
Well, depression is a real thing. And it's there's higher levels of depression than ever right now amongst young people. And then with the pandemic and all this other stuff, it makes it worse. So depression, number one, is the stigma has to end around mental health and that you're weak if you're going through stuff. You're not weak. Everybody goes through mental health stuff, depression. We all do. Some of us talk about it, some of us don't. So as a kid, you got to find somebody that you trust, that you can talk to about this, that's not going to judge you, that's not going to put you down, that's just going to listen. And then, you know, find someone to listen to you and then look for help and support, but in the right places. Often your friend isn't going to be the one at a young age to be able to give you all the advice. So you got to go out and find maybe a coach or a mentor or somebody that you can trust with your thoughts. And then get some help and, you know, figure out some things you can do little by little that will help you feel better.
Likewise, same question, like depression also in related to one question is coming, like how to handle breakup in life?
How to handle breakups?
Breakups. How to
Well,
handle?
Breakups are, they're hard. They're really, really hard because that emotional pain it's the same as physical pain. That's why they say heartbreaking, because it feels like it. Your body, your brain, honestly feels like you're under attack, like the world's ending. So this is, to me, we must, number one, allow ourselves to feel that, to go through the grieving process and feel the anger, the sadness, and cry and let it out. Because if we just try to move on and suppress it and pretend that's not there, it'll come on with us. So we go into it. But also, reminding yourself that every relationship ends at some point. It can either be a breakup or someone will die. So every, you know, and I know it's hard to understand as a young kid, but every relationship ends. Not every relationship is meant to last. So just really thinking that relationships come and go, and go back to what we talked about earlier, loving ourselves. Have that number one relationship with yourself. That will be beneficial.
All right. I hope that I'm having more 20 minutes. Okay, how to be a good student in school and colleges? How to be a good student?
How to be a good
Very
student?
Normal question, but definitely it's important.
Yeah. Well, I think earlier we talked about you got to figure out what you want to do with your life, your why. Too many times I find young people, myself, when I first went to school a long time ago, they go to school because they feel like their parents are telling them to, or they feel like they have to. So if you're struggling as a student, most likely you might be doing stuff that you don't enjoy. So to me, as a student, you have to figure out some things you enjoy and the direction you're going in, and then realize that some stuff you're not going to enjoy, but you have to do it to get to your destination. So to have the mindset that if I do this, that will get me where I want to go. And also the mindset that no matter what I do in life, I'm going to try my best. Some things I'm going to like a lot, some things I'm going to like a little bit, some things I'm going to hate, but no matter what, I want to try my best so that I know that I gave it my all. So to me, to be a student, it's real, that in balance, and make sure your life is in balance and you're not going too hard and studying 17 hours a day. You want to make sure you're enjoying the rest of life and just have a nice balanced lifestyle.
Okay, like, are you like providing your services to the like kids, like teens, or like directly parents?
Right now, I see teens and I see parents, but lately I will only see teenagers if a parent contacts me. I will work with their teenager, but the parent has to work with me too. So, because I tell the parents, I can work with your teen, but unless something changes in the home, it'll be hard for your teen to make changes. So, what I try to do is I work with the parent and the teen, and then eventually I work with the family together. And then that's where I can kind of work with, and then we all kind of help them sort out their issues, help them solve their problems, and then they can move forward with a better understanding of what each other needs. And a better understanding how to have a happier and healthier home.
All right, like this was the first phase. Like I like your expertise field. I asked the questions related to. I hope that those people who are watching or listening this like podcast or video, that will be very helpful for them. Like all the required questions I asked. Any type of question you can ask in the comment section, it will be better for us. And like coming to second phase, like I want to ask some personal questions, not exact personal, but some of the per questions which will be helpful for our audience. All right. So, are you all right with that?
Yeah.
Okay. Like, when, like, any funny moment you are having in your life as a kid, or when you used to be in school and colleges, any funny moment?
When I was going to university, I lived in a house with lots of roommates to cut bills. And I had a pet dog, and his name was Frank, and he was a wiener dog. And what he would do, he would spend his day going to all our rooms and trying to steal all our food. So my dog gained about 20 pounds in 1 year because all of us were young guys and we're just leaving our food around. So my dog, so when I think back, it was we my dog basically just ate pizza and ate chips for a year straight. And it was just a representative of our lifestyle in school because we were always studying and always going. So that's what I think about as my school days was just this dog who lived with a bunch of people and he just ate food and hung out. And just we laughed about that quite a bit.
Which is your dream place
Dream place to
in
live?
the world? In the world,
Barbados.
Barbados. I think that is under like West Indies area. Like we have a cricket team,
Yeah, Barbados is
Barbados.
in the Caribbean. It's an island. I was there. My
Caribbean, yes.
partner, that's where her dad's from. So I was out there last year and it's beautiful there. So that's the plan is to live there at some point and then be out of the cold here in Canada and be on the beach on a daily basis.
I think that is hot. That place is very hot, I think,
Very hot,
in
yeah.
comparison to Canada.
Oh yeah, that's hot there. We're cold. So I'm done. I'm 36 years old. I want to get out of the cold. So
Okay, you are 36 years old. Very nice. All right. Okay, like, have you ever been to India?
I have not. About 5 years ago, or 6 years ago, I came close to going, and my friend went, but I didn't go.
So, any plan for like visiting India?
There is, yes. Obviously, right now we can't travel, but there's something about India. I want to go there. At the time, I was reading a lot about spirituality and different things, and India was popping up. And yeah, I like Indian food. We order Indian food quite a bit, so I enjoy the food. I'm not the biggest spice fan, but I
Which
do
is your
enjoy the
favorite
food.
food of India?
I like the butter chicken and the naan bread
Butter
is very
chicken.
good. And what is this other one called? And I forget the name, but it's like a vegetable. It's a vegetable dish and like a white cream, maybe some type of a curry or something. Anyways, yeah, but the food's, I do like the food very much.
Right. I think the Indian food is available in Canada also, right? Because
yeah.
many people live there, especially
yes.
Punjabi are there.
Yes. Yes. So we have quite a few restaurants here that we order from.
So do you have any Indian friend?
Not close friends, but I do. I'm part of an organization, Peace 360, where a lot of the members are from India or they're immigrated over. So I'm having more and more Indian friends, I suppose, that I'm going to be forming relationship with through my work.
So what is the one thing do you like about India? What is the one thing, if I ask?
When I think of India, for some reason, I keep thinking of like that spirituality aspect, the culture of like when I think of chakras and I think of the body and stuff, that's, and I don't even know if that's accurate, but that's just in my mind is what I think of is culturally the idea of the body and being aligned and breathing and all and stuff and etc. That's what I think about.
Absolutely, because spirituality is given utmost priority in India also.
Okay.
Because you know that we are having spiritually attached to some of the God. Okay. So, you know that in India, there are different types of religions are there. Okay. If you go to different country, there will be one stick to one religion. But in India, you can get lots of religions are there living together. We are having diversity culture and people are from different background. But still,
okay.
we are united. So, it's a great thing, I can say.
Beautiful.
Okay. And okay, if I say, if I will give you two things, okay, so you need to choose one thing, okay, like rapid fire type, okay, I hope that you will like it. Like, if I choose to, like, if I give you to choose, like, mountain or beaches?
Mountain or beaches? Beaches.
Beaches, all right. And homemade food or street food?
Homemade food.
Homemade food. Okay, do you get pani puri there? Pani puri, momo.
I don't know. I think that's available around here. Yeah.
All right. So, are you vegetarian or non-vegetarian?
Not non-vegetarian, but I do try to limit my meat. When I grew up, it was the center of my plate. Now my center of my plate, I try to make it vegetable based or non-meat based.
What type of parent you are? Like strict or very friendly? Or like permissive, I can say, or any type authoritative. What type of parent are you?
I try to every day to be assertive. I'm friendly. I have fun. I'm caring. I'm nurturing. I'm loving. But I also have expectations and boundaries, and I teach and I hold my children accountable. But I also, as a parent, I tell them if I'm slipping up, you hold me accountable as well. You remind me. So I'm a parent who wants to be a team, and I'm just the leader. I'm not the boss. But we're a team, and I get to lead the way.
What should be the relationship? Like, how they should handle their relationship with the parents and the children?
How should we
because
handle
we see sometimes, yes, because we see sometimes conflict between the parents and the children. Conflict is there. And because sometimes we, when we are having multiple kids, it means that two or three kids, that time what happens if we give one person or one children priority, another person gets angry or becomes like that, you are loving that guy and not me. So in that case, so how can we maintain our love towards them?
Well, as parents, we have to remind ourselves that our children, they're going to be different. People have different personalities. Yes, we can have the same home, but we all have different brains. We all have different personalities. So as a parent, we got to focus on each of our kids, on their strengths, and let each of them know that we see them for their strengths and we all have weaknesses. So when we're talking, we want to make sure that we aren't calling one out all the time in front of the other one. You want to keep their dignity. You want to talk to them in a healthy way, and you don't want to play favorites, and you never want to compare them. You never want to say, hey, Bobby, why can't you be more like Susie? That is not good. That is not what you want to do.
All right. Yes, one question I forgot to ask you. Like, nowadays we see that mobile addiction in kids, all right, in teenagers also, mobile addiction. Nowadays, I hope that we are using do with our career. I get my point. So this is the, like, we can say, like, time wasting things are there. So how can we avoid, like, mobile addiction? And PUBG, you know, if we, you know, PUBG game is there, different games are there, which is like diverting their mindset from their studies. So how can they remove the mobile addiction from their life? Whether it is the responsibility of the parents or the children?
It's the responsibility of both of them. And we want to start at a young age where we limit device use and we introduce it in an appropriate way. As parents, we want to role model. We don't want to be on our device all day because otherwise our children will do the same thing. So if we have a child who's on the mobile too much, it's a teamwork. We have to go to the child and say, what's going on here? Why are you on your phone so much? Are you trying to escape something? Is there something going on in your life that's causing you trouble? Because often when we're out of balance, it means that that addiction is giving us something to our brain and we're trying to avoid our reality of our life. So as a parent, we want to help our child. We don't want to punish them. We want to say, hey, how can we help you get off your phone? How can we help you find other things to do? So you work as a team to solve the problem.
Mobile addiction is a great time wastage, I can say, for the youngsters.
Yeah.
They are using biggest regret in your life. If I ask you, regret anything in your life?
My biggest regret was, you know, I actually don't regret anything. And I know that sounds kind of spiritual, but the man I am here today, I'm very proud of who I am. I'm very proud of what I've accomplished. I'm very proud of what I have around me. So I honestly believe that if the rest of my life, I wouldn't be where I am right now if that stuff didn't happen. Yes, there was negative choices I made. Yes, I went through some really hard stuff, but I didn't know any better. I was doing the best I could. So my path was what it was. So I can honestly sit here and tell you I don't have any regrets. So that feels nice to say that.
Right. So if I give you two options to choose, like happiness or money, what will you choose?
Choose happiness. I'm not scared to have money though. I realize that having wealth opens up opportunities for happiness. It doesn't guarantee happiness, but it opens up opportunities. But I'd rather have happiness over money if I had to choose one.
Okay, like in your dictionary, like what do you call success? Like what is success for you?
To me, success is knowing who we are and being comfortable with ourselves. I think too many of us spend a lot of our lives trying to make other people happy or trying to be successful. Or we think if we do this or we go to school or we buy this or we do this job, then we'll be happy. And it never ends. So success to me is when you get comfortable and love yourself and you tell yourself that I'm important and I'm valuable and I deserve this. So to me, success is a personal development, a personal relationship with yourself.
Okay, nowadays we see that people are being materialistic. All right, they instead of loving their parents and loving their families or like wife, kids, whatever, but they are like having their own desire to buy like everything materialistic, you know. So do you think that is it good? Well, I don't think so.
It's not good. And what it is, it's a product of the media world and all the commercials and ads and Instagram and on the phone and movies and TV, this image and this idea that we can all just have all these things, but it's a myth. It's very hard to have lots of things. And also materialistic things don't bring you happiness. I know a lot of people who have huge houses, fancy cars and this and that, but they're very, very miserable. And they're very empty on the inside. So that doesn't guarantee anything other than a chase for something that doesn't exist. This idea that the stuff you have will bring you happiness, because it doesn't.
Absolutely. I can say I'm having a great interaction like with you. And it's amazing. I can say I know that my Indian accent is different from your Canadian accent. But somehow you are getting my words. So that is great, I can say. All right. So is there any difficulty do you face while I'm talking in English language?
Not too bad. I feel that your English is pretty good. Like I haven't had troubles this conversation. So yeah, I've been able to understand. A couple times I had to ask you to repeat, but that's because you cut out. So I
All
haven't.
right.
I found this to be good. I think that you communicate fine in English. So.
All right. Okay, like what's your message for them, like those who are like watching and listening this podcast or video? Like what's your message for them, like how can you approach your program with them? Like if they are interested in your program, so how can they approach you? Or what is the message for them?
Yeah, you can find me through Google search. Michael Larson, Life Upgrade is my business, Life Upgrade. My website's www.mylifeupgrade.ca. You can find me on Facebook. I have a Facebook group, parenting group, where I give lots of help in there. I'm on LinkedIn. I'm on Instagram. I'm around. Google search me up and you'll find me.
All right. Actually, I was going over your social medias, like your website, your WhatsApp, your Instagram, your Facebook, and everywhere I just visited. And I was really, really glad that a person, like a very amazing person and doing a great job. And those people who are like right now watching and listening this. So I will say one thing, like if you are having any problem with your kids, or like if you are a parent, if you are a kid, or if you want your parent to be like a successful parent, so you can contact like Michael Larson. Is very, very good person. I can say not a good person, but a dedicated and helpful guy. Or like it's a it will be a like a dream life system. You can create your life. So I think that would be better for you. Money doesn't matter. It doesn't matter like how much he charges, or it doesn't matter, but he can guarantee give you the best life, or like life-changing life. I can say life-changing life I can give you. So I think that would be very amazing experience with you. 12-week program is there, like around, I think, 3-month program is there. So absolutely fine with that. And I hope, can you disclose like how much price do you charge? So that they think affordable.
Yeah, the program, the 12-week program is $1,000 US. And I do offer payment plans. So I can break that down into 2 payments or 3 payments. So that is my price. And I hope that people reach out to me. If finances is a barrier, on my social media, you'll find free help. It's not going to be as great as the help that you can get working with me. But most definitely, I try to provide value and help for people where money is an obstacle, because I understand that not everybody has money. So so if you find me and you can still benefit from my stuff, and then maybe when you money situation changes, then we can work together.
Yes, absolutely. So guys, like those people who are watching right now, like yesterday also I visited the YouTube channel and I saw like around 50 plus videos were there, and it was all amazing. Like though it was very less views, I can say, but the content inside the video, it was amazing. And it is like we cannot get from like other sources. Like if you go to Google or if you go to YouTube, you cannot get it. But the amazing content is there. So I think that would be very helpful if you are affordable, and if you can afford that, so go for that. And definitely you are going to have a life-changing parent, or I can say teen. So I'm very, very glad. I can say like it's amazing to have you, and like I will definitely want to meet you, but it's not possible. Yeah, still if possible, if you come to India any day, or if possible, definitely we want to meet you. And I hope that you get some business from India also, and that would be very great, and relationship with India will be much more better, I can say. All right. And
sounds good. Thank you so much for having me, and I've enjoyed our conversation, and let's stay in touch, and let's stay connected, and see what happens.
All right. And thank you so much, and for accepting my invitation to join my Sanjay Agarwal show. And I'm really glad to have you, and I hope that this podcast, this video will be useful or helpful for some kind of people. And that's it. And thank you so much. And we say like Indian namaste.
Okay. Namaste. You take care.
All right. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.